let's talk about Rook Endgames. We're halfway through this part in the book. And we talked the last time about like King and Pawn Endgames and Minor Piece Endgames. Now we're talking about Rook Endgames. So the most important Rook Endgames that we're going to study are going to be the Lucina position and the Philidor position. This is two endgames, well, they're sort of similar, that I would show my students if we ever do look at endgames.
Oh, okay.
They are pretty important.
Good, and I've heard of that. What are they called? Lucina, what was the other one?
Philidor.
Yeah, I've heard of both of those. I don't know what they are.
Well, now you will after this.
Yeah.
And yeah, Rook and Pawn endgames are like the most common kinds of endgames, typically. More common than Minor Piece or Queen endgames. So if you're ever going to study any kind of endgame, it should be a Rook endgame.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense, since you don't get those rolling until later in the game anyway.
The Lucina position, in parenthetical, the sacred key to all Rook endgames. Wow. It's time to learn the holy grail of Rook endgames. The sacred key that allows you to know stuff and stuff like that. Useful advice. This is one of those bits of chess knowledge that every serious player must possess. It's true.
Mm-hmm.
The Lucina position was first published in 1634 by Salvio. For some reason, it wasn't in an earlier book by Lucina. So let's look at the diagram that he shows.
All right. Cool. Let's
skip all the words he says.
He said 1634?
That sounds right.
A long time.
1634, right.
It's been around for a long time.
Maybe even like the rules of chess were a little different then. Who knows?
Hey, Pam. Pam says, this is where I have trouble.
Right. Well, Rook endgames are pretty tough. They're very technical.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think some endgame knowledge is actually good for all levels, but...
Well, it's all about efficiency of your learning.
Mm-hmm.
You know, an 800 shouldn't learn this.
Right.
It's going to be a little bit of a waste of time. Even if they remember it, you know, they should learn, you know, how this is how horsey moves, stuff like that. All right, so here it's white to play, but white wins no matter whose move it is. The feature of the Lucina position is that there's an extra pawn on the seventh rank.
Mm-hmm.
It's about to queen. Both kings are joined in the battle, but white's king is in front of the pawn.
Okay.
This is what's going to differentiate the Lucina position from the Philidor position, because they're very similar.
Right.
But the stronger king is in front of the pawn in a Lucina position. That's what's important to remember. So white needs to do two things if he wants to win. He needs to move the king off of d8 and then queen. Those are the two things you have to do. The difficulty lies in the fact that black can try to like perpetual check your king if you move your king out of the way.
Oh, okay, yeah. When you say stronger king...
The side with the pawn.
Okay. That's what I thought you meant. Sure.
So, the problem is the checks and such. Okay. So, the first way to try to accomplish this goal is to play rook e7 check.
Mm-hmm.
And then, hopefully, the king will get out of the way, and then we can just step out, and then we win. So instead, they should obviously do this, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then we're not really making any progress if we do this.
Right.
So that's not going to work. Instead, we should play rook f2 check, xclam. Useful advice. Trapping the enemy king away from the action is almost always a good thing to do. That's true. So this makes the black king leave the scene of the battle. Right? He can't go king e6, then we can step up out of the way, and we won't get checked by the rook.
Right.
And then we'll queen next move without any problem. So the king has to go out of here. Okay, now this is a key moment. Oh, here he asks, of the following moves, which one do you think is correct? King e8, king e7, check, or rook f4? So usually I ask the question, but he actually had one in here for us.
All right.
Oh, Laszlo's in here.
Hey, Laszlo, how's it going?
The and neon
Christopher
Laszlo.
James.
Swag God? How's it going, Swag God?
Yeah, hey, Swag God. All right, so let me see. You're seeing which is... appropriate.
Everything feels like an epic tale with Silman's commentary. Yeah, that's true.
So moving the king one of those two places or the rook, you're saying, which is the next move?
Now, you know, for the record, they all win eventually, but only one of them makes progress that wins.
Right.
Winning progress. Got a couple different responses in the chat. Jay Chester's chiming in. Puts the chess in Jay Chester, huh? So in a game, just trial and error until you get the right one. Well, that only works for 50 moves, right? You can't just keep trying stuff until, you know, you run out of time eventually. Looks like Chad is on the right track somewhat, mostly. Well, we got a couple different answers, but...
I'm not sure about it. To be honest here.
How about you tell us? I'll never tell. I'm like Johnny Tightlips. What do you think, Karen? Need that rook bridge. Yeah, that's a good way of putting it. Alright, I don't know nothing. Johnny Tightlips, do you see where the shooter's coming from? I see a lot of things. We are doing the Lucina and Philidor positions, Christopher James. Very astute. Karen's not giving away any information either.
I don't know. I just don't know.
Alright, well, let's look at them.
Okay.
So let's take a look at each choice
and study them. I was looking at each one, and each one seemed bad.
Okay.
And I definitely don't understand Rook F4.
Right. That's the right one. That's why you don't understand.
Yeah.
So let's look at, first of all, King E8. It's important to understand the flaws with all of these ideas, and so we know what, you know, not to do.
Mm-hmm.
But King E8 doesn't really make any sense anyway, because after check, you just have to go back.
Right.
Unless you want to hang your rook.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not going to help.
Right.
King E7, that makes a little bit more sense. This is Pam's suggestion. And this is like the normal thing that you'd want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Get your king out of the way, promote the pawn, right?
Right.
So, of course, we have to check. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you promote the pawn. And then, haha, we get out of the way, right?
And you just get checked.
Checked again, exactly. Now, don't move your king upwards. You'll lose your pawn.
Mm-hmm.
But here comes another check. Now, it seems like, okay, we can just go here, and now it's buenos no checks, right?
Mm-hmm.
But not quite, because we go back, and now your only reasonable move is to protect your pawn with your king again.
Right.
So you've not made any progress yet.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So King E7's not going to get it done. Rook G2 check. This move's kind of silly, because he'll just go back.
Right.
And then, okay, we can go back.
So I figured Rook F4 had to be it, but I just couldn't quite figure out what...
Rook F4, here's the idea. You want to run your king out, but then you want to block with the rook at the timely moment.
Oh, okay. So that the king can take if there's an exchange or something?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, the king... Well, right. Yeah, if we blocked with the rook when it was here, it would just lose our rook.
Yeah,
okay. So we're going to block with the rook when our king can help. And Rook F4 is as far away as we can get from this king, but still close enough that our king can approach without losing our pawn.
Okay.
I'll show you what I mean with these moves.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Mysterious rook move. This certainly looks odd, doesn't it? However, the idea of using the rook to shelter its king from upcoming checks makes sense. Nimzowitsch described this maneuver as building a bridge. That's why people were saying that in the chat.
Okay.
I don't really know why it's called building a bridge, because... It does. I mean, maybe like how the king moves like a triangle is kind of like how in a bridge it has like that pattern in it. But I don't know. But anyways, let's see how it works. So black can't really do anything, right? I mean, there's nothing that black can really do. So let's just wait. And then we'll get our king out. And then here. Again, we can't lose our pawn, so let's go like this, right? Mm-hmm. Check. And then king d5. And this is why we have our rook here, so now we can go there. And the game's over. Mm-hmm. We promote the pawn by force now.
I see.
And so we built the bridge.
The old zig and zag.
Right, the classic zig and the zag. Yes. Now, I should mention, I don't know if he talks about this later, but I'll just mention it right now, that you don't want to, like, build a bridge in this position. You need the king to be a little further away. If you try to build the bridge now, well, you can't even step out. But let's say I let you step out, just to prove my point. My point is that if you're trying to build a bridge here, and you think that you're going to make it, right, my king is close enough, I can trade rooks, and we draw.
Oh, yeah.
So you have to make sure that you do like he said, you check the king away, and then you build the bridge.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and any random move, etc., like we saw. So that's a classic technique that every strong player knows. I've done this myself.
So you have had that?
Yes, yes.
So that absolutely probably does happen a lot.
Maybe not exactly with the D pawn. Maybe it was an E pawn or an F pawn. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I've had this more than once. I've done this in blitz chess.
Mm.
Yes, absolutely. I prefer not my system by son of a bitch. That is good.
Wait, George Hornsby said something. What if rook F2 check, then king E6?
King E8. And then we promote by force. You're going to have to give up your rook for it. I mean, in an endgame, things aren't like... I mean, they're obvious if you see them, right? So you either see them or you don't. So you can't really say something's obvious or not.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess it could be pretty obvious. Like, here it's obvious that white's going to queen. You know, once you get here.
Yeah, don't worry about being... You know, don't worry about asking any, you know, obvious or dumb questions. Because, you know...
So we can sum up the winning ideas. Force the black king away from the action. Prepare to build that bridge by putting your rook on the fourth rank. And move your king out from the pawn, in front of the pawn. And then block the checks with the rook.
Mm-hmm, a little shield.
Yeah.
Now let me make sure we didn't miss any. I think that was it. I hate this mouse so much.
Mm-hmm. I remember all that.
I just didn't see
it. That was like Johnny Tight Lips. That's when I was talking about that.
Okay. All right, I'm caught up.
All right. So now let's talk about the Philidor position. A critical defensive stand. So it'll also be rook and pawn against rook. But here, you'll see that the weaker side's king is in front. See, we got the black king's going to be in front here.
Mm-hmm.
Now that you've mastered the Lucina position, you'll take a look at something that's almost as important, the Philidor position. Let's follow this old adage, the picture is worth 1,000 words. Then we can look at this picture here. Draw. So the Philidor position's a draw. White's a pawn up and enjoys a superior king's position. Oh, what did we get? A donation. $10
by Raj. Yay. Hey, thanks, thank Raj. You, Raj B. How's it going? Nice. Yay.
So that's a lot of advantages for white, but it's still a draw. People lose this kind of position all the time. I've had this position defensively as well.
Mm-hmm.
And as white. I mean, maybe I had black, but, you know, I had the extra pawn as well. In many games. Blitz games, slow games, rapid games. All the time.
And you've had it go both ways?
Oh, yeah. I've had this kind of position with black, mm-hmm. messed it up where it's losing, and then still drawn it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's tough.
Yeah.
Especially in blitz, like when you have, you know, 10, 15 seconds left, you're just like sort of banging out.
Yeah. Moves. You have to, yeah, it's hard to think.
Yeah, and this is a little bit tougher than the other, than a Lucina position.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Pat Sirius. Yeah, this is fundamental in-game stuff.
Definitely.
But I think a lot of people need it. Silman's a poet at heart. He does seem like he has a philosopher's soul as well.
All right, before we look at this position, though, let's look at when things can go wrong, when animals attack. Let's look at this one first here. There we go. A passive rook. So the Philidor position should be a draw, but things can turn ugly if the defender's rook becomes passive, giving the stronger side free rein to do whatever he wishes. Useful advice. The idea of swinging the rook over to the other side is worth remembering, since you'll be able to make use of it again and again during the course of your chess career.
Swinging the rook over to the other side.
Yeah.
What?
Well, that's white to play. Let's swing our rook over to the other side.
You mean just over to the A file? I don't know.
Yeah.
All right.
That's the other side. Okay. As opposed to this side. This is the other side.
I act like it's some kind of novel idea to swing your rook over.
Swing it on over.
All right.
Yeah. White wins because black's rook stuck on the first rank. We're threatening mate.
Right.
And there's nothing you can do about it at this point. I mean, I guess the best you can do is go here and protect your rook, but then I'll queen my pawn after I trade rooks.
Mm-hmm.
Frankly, obviously. So a passive rook can lose you the game. And right. I've lost endgames like this.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. And I've won it like this as well.
Now, glad you're enjoying it, Raj.
We can look at a similar position here.
Bring it around town.
Right. Classic sponge. Gotta stop on your... Which foot? Left foot? Don't forget it? I forgot it. Unlike how it says I should not forget it. I did forget it. If you're defending a Philidor position, don't allow your rook to become passively placed. So let's glance at this equally hopeless passive rook situation. So it's a different pawn. We moved it over to the left, so it's a bishop pawn. But it's the same idea. We swing it on over.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure I have white to play here. Yep. Rook A7. Now, okay, now we can try to stop that, right? With this move. King B8.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
But it's short-lived because we give the big check. Has to go here, check, here, mainly, etc. Probably going to win this position. So, yeah. Sometimes, however, you can play badly and still survive. Let's take a look at if we shift it over even more. Like that.
Mm-hmm.
So here's a rule. If your opponent's extra pawn is a knight pawn or a rook pawn and your king is in front of it, you should effortlessly draw. Even if you've played terribly, like how black's position's about as bad as possible here.
Right.
But this is still a draw, actually. Hmm. Yeah. If white could only swing his rook over to the Z file, that doesn't exist, then he could try to win it. But... that's not how you play chess, so what are you going to do? He gives this variation, like, some check. Do I not have the... I do. It just didn't make the noise. Okay. Check. And you can't really make any progress.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, you could even lose if you're not careful. If you go here, I check you, then I take your rook and I take your pawn. Oops. So that's not going to work. So this position, even though it looks pretty bad... it's a draw because the knight pawn doesn't give us enough room to go over to over here where you can't even see where my mouse is anymore
because,
mm-hmm. you know, we cut out the layout like that. Yeah. Let's see. Anything else? Yeah. Oh, yeah. One stop on your right foot. Don't forget it. See, I knew I forgot it. All right. So, reminder. These kinds of passive rook positions are winning for the stronger side if the pawn... on the sixth rank is a bishop, queen, or king pawn. But a knight or rook pawn is still a draw, since we can't swing it on over. Alright, so let's go back to the first position that we looked at. It was the pure Philidor position, where we're not so passive yet as black. There we go. Okay. So black to move, it's a draw in this position with black to play. You'll be able to draw any grandmaster easily with this position, he says. He wasn't even joking. So here's the idea, is first of all, in order for white to even try to win this, He's got to move his king forward.
Mm-hmm.
So all you got to do is play rook h6, cutting the king off. So he'll never move forward. Never, ever. So black is aware that playing passively failed because we can swing the rook over. For example, if you play rook f7, like that, because we don't want to let the rook check the king.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll just play rook f7, but we'll swing it on over. Rook a8. And this move is actually probably going to win now. Yeah. It is winning. Yeah, once I trade rooks, I'll just go here. You can't really stop me from trading rooks unless you move your rook up here. But then I'll check and I'll be able to move my king in front.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like this, for example. Now you can't check me anymore and I'm threatening mate. And if you move your king out and I check you, now it's going to be a Lucina position. Remember? Mm-hmm. With the stronger king in front? That's why you look at the Lucina position first.
Mm.
So that's not going to work. Now you might say, okay, so playing passively doesn't work, which makes sense. Usually you don't want to play too passively, especially in a rook endgame. So let's try to make an active move, right? Check from behind. That's how you do it, right? But even this doesn't work. After check, we have a strong move here. King d6. Yes. So now, if you check from behind, I get opposition, and then we're going to do, like, in the Lucina position like we just looked at. Or if you check from the side, I push it. And then you've got Buenos no checks yet again. Your king will have to run out if you don't want to get mated. Then my king will eventually step in front, and I'll win that way. I already forgot the Lucina position. Funny stuff. Believable and funny. So the idea is that rook h6, if you check me, which I think is probably the move, yeah, check, king e8. Now you can't move your king upwards. You just can't do it. Not yet, at least. Okay, we can try to swing the rook around. All you need to do is mark time. Mark Timonov, am I right? So now you might say, okay, you can't move your king up. I getcha. So let's go with the pawn here. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Now we'll move our king up. Then we'll mate you, or you'll run away. And if you run away, I'll get my king in front, and we'll be in a Lucina position yet again. But now here is where, because you've pushed your pawn, we can go back and check you, and you can't go in front of your pawn like we looked at earlier.
Right, yeah.
So now there's no way to escape the checks. Yes, can't hide behind the pawn. There's no cover. So, yeah, you can do something like rook a4 to block with the rook. Right? But, you know, I can just check you and take. And then we saw this in earlier parts. It's a draw.
Mm-hmm.
Or you don't even have to do that. You can even just go here. Because how are you going to make progress with white? There's no way. White can't make any progress here at all. Now you could step up, I just check you. Nothing you can do about it. You wish you could have gone king e6. So that's the idea with this Philidor position. You keep the rook here on the third rank, black's third rank.
Mm-hmm.
You can't ever win without the help of your king. It's impossible. So you can move the pawn forward, but then you can't walk in front of your pawn because you moved it too far forward.
Right, okay.
So that's the drawing technique. So rule, the defender's drawing plan in the Philidor position is to use his rook to block the stronger side's king from stepping into the rank in front of the pawn. So all you gotta do is go back and forth with your rook until they push the pawn forward, and then you bring your rook back. Maximum distance, might as well go all the way back.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can just keep checking. Nice. Nice. All right, so Mark Timonov, yes. Good joke. Alright, so trap the enemy king away from the action. As we saw in our study of the Lucina position, trapping the enemy king away from the action is an important idea. in the winning process and the only key idea for the defender. The logic is easy to grasp. Let's see. He says a lot of random stuff. It doesn't matter. All right, so let's look at this position. We'll put the king here. This king there. Here. Give him a pawn. And then in the corner, we'll make it white to move. All right, thanks to the extra pawn and thanks to the fact that Black's king is so far away, White is clearly winning. Probably you can guess the winning move at this point.
Is that a rhetorical question?
No. It's only one winning move.
For White, let's see.
Thanks, intelligent. I try my best. Dang, the chat's not even getting it right. Come on, chat.
Maybe rook a6?
That's what the chat wanted. Oh. But we're trying to trap the king away from the action. If you play rook a6, I can just walk my king in front of your pawn.
Oh, okay.
So you want to not let my king get in front of your pawn, so then white can win with a Lucina position.
Okay, rook f1?
Yeah, rook f1. See, if our rook is here, your king is never entering the position. My king can always step in front, and we'll win like a Lucina position. It's also important to note that if you try this so that your king can run in front, the king and pawn endgame's losing because I'm going to be two squares in front of my pawn.
Right, yeah.
So that's going to be a pretty easy win. Mm-hmm. So rook f1 is the win, and other moves don't win. So yeah, you gotta trap that enemy king away from the action. Don't let him get in front of the pawn, then he could do a Philidor position. The king's position is critical.
Okay.
Right, you need, if you wanna win, your king has to be in front of the pawn. And if you wanna draw, their king has to be in front of the pawn. So
okay.
Gotta cut that king off. Useful advice. Trapping the enemy king away from the action for either defensive or offensive reasons is often a very effective strategy. That's true. Now let's look at a different example.
Yeah, I was thinking that too at first, Pat. Serious.
Right, a lot of people said rook a6.
But... Well, no, he was saying even king c6. I mean, that was my first thought, and then I was like, no, that's not right. Trapped a lonely monarch in his dungeon of shameful solitude.
That is like what he wrote.
Or something.
All right, so black to play. What do you guys think about this position? Did I make it black to play? Yeah, I did.
All right.
A little bit extra pawns on the board this time.
It's gotten harder. Okay.
The chat's picking up on it, though. Black can draw this position, Mr. Hornsby. So... Black to play, yes. Working class hero, XXX. First time catching you guys live after having been an avid GM Ben fan. Thank you for catching us, Ono. Oh no, you didn't. Yes, she did, Peter. I saw her. All right, jeez. Basically, what you're saying is that king plus pawn versus rook wins. Well, king plus rook plus pawn, right? Rook plus pawn versus rook wins if the enemy king can't get involved. Yes, it's almost 100% the case. It's 11 p.m. there. Oh, right. It's a European-friendly stream almost, right?
Yeah, kind of.
Pretty, yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. I'm up that late sometimes watching a stream. Or on a stream.
I'm never asleep before 11 p.m., so.
I occasionally do, but not usually. Darn. I know, I've gotten confused already. Wait, who's to play?
I'm sorry. Black. To play.
Okay.
You got it.
This one's hard.
But that's a good question. What if it's white to play? What would white do? That'll help you find black's best move.
Well, it seems like... Well, I don't know. It seems like white would want to get rid of those black pawns.
Okay. Can't argue with that. Definitely would want that. So what's the move he would play?
King c5.
Definitely. King c5 wins the d-pawn. There's no way to defend mm-hmm. it. If you go here, I'll fork you and then win it.
Right.
So king c5 is a winning move. That's why black actually has to prevent that. And there's only one legal way to prevent it.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Well, okay, so rook c8?
Yeah, rook c8 okay. draws. Now the white king is trapped away from the sphere of action.
Okay.
And there's no way that the white king can approach. And so you'll save your pawn. If you try to attack it with the rook, I can defend with the king.
Right, yeah.
Obviously, black has no way of winning this without some help from white, because he's down a pawn. Mm-hmm. But this is enough to hold the draw. Your king is so out of place that it can't be won with best play anymore. For example, let's say king b6 is what he gives. We can even do one of these ourselves. Why mm-hmm. not play actively? Doesn't hurt. Yeah. As long as you keep control over the c-file, there's no way that he can approach.
Okay.
And there's nothing white can do to make any progress. I guess white could try to do like this. But while he's doing that, you could just go here and take it. So, it's not really going to be effective.
Right, yeah.
To spend all that time. So this is a draw. So that's all there is to this rook and pawn endgame section. I assume we'll do more rook and pawn endgame stuff later in the book, though.
Yeah, I think it does revisit.
Definitely.
And at a deeper level.
It's not exactly rocket science. Yeah.
Hey, working class hero. Both lock the king out and attack the F pawn.
All right, last part of this part. Party of the first part. We'll talk about queen versus king and pawn. So one side will have a queen and the other side will just have a pawn.
Okay.
So this is no contest, especially if the stronger side's king is close to the pawn. But even if the king is on the other side of the board, the queen can sometimes beat a king and a pawn, with occasional exceptions, when the pawn's in the seventh rank. There are two ways of trying to win with a queen against a pawn. One is the queen lands on the pawn's queening square. If I, you know, if you've got a pawn here, and I put my queen in front, just land right there, mm-hmm. I'll win 100%. I could just take, it doesn't matter where my king is.
Yeah.
Take all day, right? Or another way to win is that the queen forces the black or the weaker side's king to step in front of its pawn. Right. Then when you step in front of the pawn, I'll slowly bring my king up. Mm-hmm. You'll step out of the way, I'll force you back in front, and then you'll have to step back in front, I'll bring my king up, and et cetera, et cetera. I'll slowly bring my king up, and then I'll take your pawn.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the two winning techniques. So let's first talk about a queen against a pawn on the sixth rank. The sixth rank isn't very good. Almost always going to be losing. White to move. Ah. Oh, what happened here? It says it's winning. Hey, when I press the wrong button, which is occasionally happens.
I feel like this ribbon thing isn't supposed to be showing.
What do you mean, of the shirt?
Yeah, I fixed it.
All right, so white ends things quickly by permanently stopping the black pawn in its tracks. Queen check. You'll move your king somewhere. And queen e1. This is the easiest way to win queen against pawn.
Mm-hmm.
There's no possible way that you can do it.
This is way less complicated than the rook yeah. stuff.
Well, this is the first part of this.
I know, it'll get harder. I just heard a noise. That couldn't possibly be Ben. that was. Hey, Master John, how's it going?
And so forth. All right, let's try a little bit tougher example since Karen was complaining how easy that one was.
No. No, you did. I was just pointing it out. I know it just starts out with the easiest example.
Yeah. Why you gotta build.
Like a ribbon thing, like sticking out. My shirt's on wrong, but I'm not going to interrupt the chest.
So, rook pawns are often exceptions to rules that we've seen multiple times in this book.
Yeah.
And it will be an exception when the pawn's in the 7th rank, for the record.
Okay.
But here are the pawns in the 6th rank. White doesn't want the pawn to get to the 7th rank, then it will be a draw, as we'll discuss coming up here.
Okay.
But he can't get his queen to h1 yet, can he? Not as easy as the other time. We just checked and put
right.
the queen in front.
Yeah.
So let's go check.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if the king goes to h2, we can step our king up, and he can't push his pawn. So he'll play king h1, threatening to push his pawn. That's the threat. So we've got to check him again. Queen d5, check, x-clam. King g1.
Hey, Fortuna.
Queen d4 check. Never give him a chance to play h2. King, as long as he doesn't go king h2, it makes sense. Check. Now we got him. Check. Fork. Now guess what he has to do? Go in front of his pawn, right?
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise he loses it. Then we can step our king up. And in fact, here it's actually very easy. He has to play king h1, it's the only legal move.
Mm-hmm.
And then we take the pawn and we'll win this position.
Yeah.
Refer to part one if you don't know how to win with the queen.
So you're saying you want to get him onto h2?
Yeah, you want to get the king onto h2.
Mm-hmm.
So he doesn't play pawn h2. So that's the deal, is that mm-hmm. you can't ever let him play pawn h2. It'll draw, as we'll see coming up. So we have to force his king to h2.
Oh, I see. Okay.
If you ever try to bring your king up when he can play h2, he will.
All right.
So we have to make a series of checks until we fork him. He has to go here, otherwise he loses his pawn, and et cetera, mainly, et cetera.
Okay.
And this will win even if the king didn't have to give up the pawn. Like, if the king could have gone to the I file, which doesn't exist, then this would still win. We would just have to check him again, forking the king and pawn,
mm-hmm.
and the king moves in front, we bring the king up. But here it's easy because it's a rook pawn.
Right, right.
So he has to step up and lose it.
Hey, sarcastic guillotine.
Guillotine.
This seems like an important in-game Ivysaur. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. And here's a rule. Lone queen versus king and a pawn in the 6th rank is almost always a win for the queen. That makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so let's look at like this. Mm-hmm. If it's on the 7th rank.
This is a sad day in the office when you have this position.
That's true. All right. The first time that Silman says that he came into contact with this position, he was 14. Years old. He's about 1600.
Mm-hmm.
And a friend called and gave him this position over the phone.
Mm.
You know you have a nerdy friend when he's calling you.
Right.
Hey, can you check out this position? Okay, it's king on d2. I'd be like, shut up, nerd. Hang up. White's a queen up, said Silman. Yes, but I bet you can't win it, his friend said. I laughed and agreed on a 50-cent wager. And then he lost his money when he couldn't win it, did Silman. But it is winning. Here's the rule. The endgame is won by maneuvering the queen so that Black's king is forced to step in front of his pawn. This is what I was mentioning earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Since the pawn can't move for a moment, then you'll bring your king up. He'll try to get his king out of the way so he can promote his pawn, and you force him back in front. He'll have to go back in front. You step your king up again. And you repeat the process over and over, as we'll see.
Mm-hmm.
So, check. Now you have to play king d1. You can't let me go there like we saw in the previous example. Check. Now, you don't want to go in front, because then I'll walk my king up. So you're going to have to step away. King c2. Queen e3. Stopping e1 queen.
Mm-hmm.
And attacking the pawn. Black only has one reasonable move. And now here it is. Queen d3 check. This is how we force the enemy king in front of his own pawn.
Right.
He steps away, we take it. So he has to go here, only move. Then here comes the white king. Exactly. Now all white has to do is keep repeating this process. King f2. Obviously, king f1 would make it a little easier because then we check here and he has to go here.
Yeah.
So king f2 is a little bit tougher. We can play queen f2, queen d2 rather. Still learning the notation. You don't want to go here because then we'll go there. So he can go up here. Check. Again, you don't want to block your pawn, so you go here. And then queen back here, stopping the queen. Have to go here. And then here it is. And then king c6, I'm guessing. Yep. And then we can play all these moves.
So the only time you move your king is when their king is in front of the pawn.
Yeah, you can't let him queen.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to make sure his king is blocking the pawn. Then you can bring your king up.
George says, are these all only moves or are there alternatives for white?
There are alternatives for white, yeah, but this is very efficient. Intelligent, you're correct that this doesn't work for the F file and for the H file. If the pawn's in the seventh rank, which we'll go over as well, of course.
Oh, okay, definitely.
Yeah.
Doesn't work for the F in what other file? C H. File? Oh.
Oh, and C, yeah. A bishop pawn and a rook pawn.
Okay.
Right. Well, we'll see why.
Yeah,
it's because of stalemate, actually. Let's see, where does he put the king here? Lost my place. King d4. Then, oh yeah, king d4. Yeah. And then king d2. See, now it's even easier because our king is helping. We can just go here. We couldn't do that before because it would take us.
Yeah.
Now he has to go here.
Mm-hmm.
Etc. Mainly etc. So that's the standard technique to win with queen against pawn. If only Silman had known that, he would have saved his 50 cents against that kid that called him. Once I knew about this, he sent me another position. Your friend is a jerk. So, unless it's all just made up, which is possible.
Yeah, probably it's made up.
So, a rook pawn. Bet you can't win this. Angry at the insult, I said, what are you talking about? You just showed me how to win it. Of course I'm going to win it, idiot. He didn't say that, but you know.
Mm.
All right, so make sure I made it white to move here. Check. We'll do the same thing, right? Check. He won't block our pawn his own pawn intentionally. That would be a little bit too helpful here. Looks like he got him, right?
Mm-hmm.
Here comes the king, and white's still gonna win, it seems. So it would seem. But this is the difference, right? In the other position, when the pawn was moved over, we had to move our king in front of the pawn.
Mm-hmm.
Here we don't have to move our king in front of the pawn. We can play king h1, and you cannot take my pawn because of stalemate.
Oh.
And so I'm always threatening to queen. And so this is stopping black from having to move in front of his pawn, and thereby stopping the white king from approaching. Because as you pointed out, we can only approach when his king is in front of the pawn. We don't have to put our king in front of the pawn because of stalemate.
Okay.
We don't have to defend our pawn. And so this is a draw. Nothing else to do here.
Mm-hmm. That's pretty cool.
They don't
work there.
So bishop and rook pawns draw in this scenario, whereas knight and center pawns are going to win. Yeah, in fact, he gives an example of a rook pawn too. For posterity's sake. I don't know why he moved the king. Okay. White to move still draws. What about a rook pawn? We've seen how rook pawns often prove an exception in many endgames, and it's true here as well. Black's ideas can instantly be grasped after check when we move in front of our pawn. It's already stalemate.
Yeah.
So we have to get out of stalemate, but then we'll get out in front of our pawn.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the problem with the rook pawn. You're forcing me to move in front of my pawn, but you're also forcing me into stalemate. You can never force me in front of my pawn where it won't be stalemate. You can never force me to go here unless you check me, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have to check me. And if you check me somewhere where it's not attacking my pawn, I'll just not, you know, I won't go in front of my pawn, or even here, I guess. But if you have to check me and fork, like we saw earlier in those earlier examples, like right. When the pawn and king were up one.
Yeah, right.
Or when we were over here, you'd have to walk in front of your pawn. So here, when you walk in front of your pawn, though, it's stalemate. So there's nothing that white could even try here to win. Yeah. So that's it for queen and pawn, queen against pawn endgames. See if anybody says anything important. Silman got hustled. It's true. He did, if these stories were true. No, it looks like everybody understands.
Yay.
Nice. All right, so summing up, some of the stuff that is summing up was from last time, like Trebuchet and such.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Sinnerman, how's it going? These are, because I'm not a Twitch partner, the videos on demand are on Twitch for, I think, for only 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. So actually, I think all of these should still be on there, but maybe not. I'm not sure. But you can definitely look on the Chess Club.
YouTube.
So just go on there and look for Chess Club and Scholastic Center of Atlanta. I should add that link to my Twitch profile.
Right.
So people can find it. But yeah, the videos are definitely all.
Also, it should be like a Moobot thing, too.
Moobot. I agree with that.
Come on, Kangaroo. Get on there. What are you doing?
Yeah, Kangaroo could maybe add a Moobot, or I could.
Next time, for part 5, we'll look at endgames for Class B players.
Mm-hmm.
16 to 1800.
Yay. Hey, Mr. Soman.
More king and pawn, and rook and pawn, and minor piece endgames.
Definitely.
Just more complicated versions of what we looked at.